Hello. Good afternoon, everybody. I guess we're all here. Okay, I guess I can get the event started. Well, thank you everyone for joining us for a celebration of the life of Lenka Peterson O'Connor. I see so many faces here. I'm so happy to see everybody. Our program today is a number of family members speaking, as well as two close friends of Lenka's and three presentations. After that, we'll open up to all friends attending. As well, there will be a website launched soon where we'll all be able to post our thoughts and memories. We do ask that you remain muted until it's your turn to speak. At this point, I imagine we're all familiar with Zoom meetings, but just in case, I'll go over it. At the bottom left corner of your screen, you can mute your mic and turn off your camera. Now, since we have a lot of speakers, I'll mention the view options. At the top right of the Zoom window, you see a little button that says view. If you click that, you can change it to speaker view, which will highlight just the person speaking, or you can keep it on gallery where you'll be able to see everybody. As well, the gallery probably won't contain all of the people on it. So if you look at the right corner of the gallery, there's a little arrow. You can click that and it'll kind of scroll through everybody that's in the meeting. I guess I'll get started. We did receive a few words from Lenka herself regarding her wishes for this event. She said, "If you want to put anything on a program, I'd like you to just say that I always prayed for help to try to bring love into every life my life touched." She did. Arrange whatever memorial service will make you feel comfortable. I'd like very much to have you just sit around at home and tell each other nice or funny things you remember about me. So with that, we'll get started. I'd like to introduce our first speaker today, Lenka's daughter, Glennis. Oh, Glennis, you might have to unmute yourself.
I am unmuted.
Now you're unmuted. Okay, great.
You can hear me?
I can hear you. Great.
Okay, hi. Hi, everybody. Hi. So as mom used to say to me, when we speak over the phone, I reach my arms out to all of you and I'm giving you a big hug right now. So I hope you can feel it. So I'm just gonna say a few words about our mom, who lived through roughly 98 opening nights, 1,395 stage performances, changed 5,475 baby diapers, cooked 11,000 family dinners, packed 5,250 school lunches, endured two total hip replacements, took countless phone calls reassuring her anxious daughter that she was a good actress, and watched one of her sons chase another one of her sons around the house with an axe, screaming, "Either he goes or I go." But don't get the wrong idea. We were a happy family. In the car on a family trip, We once made up a song, "The Jolly O'Connor Kids." I'm not going to sing it for you now. So it's April 1920, and 19-year-old Maria Magdalena Leinweber leaves her hometown of Selberec, Hungary, as she comes to the U.S. and settles in Omaha, Nebraska. And around the same time, Dr. Sven Isaacson leaves Stockholm, Sweden, to settle in Des Moines, Iowa. But thinking Des Moines was pronounced Des Moines, he missed his stop and he got off at Omaha. So he soon met Maria Magdalena, who by then went by the nickname Lenke. And they married in 1924. A year later, Lenke, with her deep symphonic Hungarian accent, and Sven with his rich rhythmic Swedish accent, had a daughter. And they named her Betty Ann. 2 years later, Betty Ann got a baby brother, Peter, whom she adored. And by the third grade, Betty Ann had had it with being one of about 50 other Betty Anns at Harrison and Dundee School, and she changed her name to Lenka with an A. And at Central High School, Lenka joined a dozen different clubs, worked with several volunteer groups, made honor roll, played classical piano recitals, performed at school plays, went to weekend dances, and by junior year, she was so tired that on a history exam, she wrote across the page, "The answer is love," plunked her head on the desk and fell asleep. And 2 years into the University of Iowa, Lenka left and lived at the rehearsal club in New York City and then joined the USO. And it was around the end of World War II and she toured the Pacific in the play Kiss and Tell. And back in the US, on a visit home in Omaha, watching a play at the Omaha Community Playhouse, she grew smitten with a handsome Irishman performing on stage. And after the curtain call, she found him, pretended they knew each other, got him to drive her home, and married him. Daniel Patrick O'Connor and Lenka made their way to New York City, where Dan went into television production and news at NBC, and Lenka started auditioning. And this was around 1949. And through the next decade, Lenka acted in television dramas, Broadway, Off-Broadway, daytime, radio, feature films. She was in the first roster of actors that Elia Kazan and Robert Lewis settled on when starting the Actors Studio. She gave birth to 5 children and moved 3 times. And she never stopped acting. She acted right up to age 90 or so. She never stopped learning, always learning new techniques, creating new bits of business with each performance, always going back to the Actors Studio sessions. She ached to be in musicals. And so she taught herself to sing. And she went on to co-star in Me and My Girl, Crazy for You, and Quilters, for which she received a Tony nomination. She taught acting at the Metropolitan Opera Studio for 5 years, which brings me to a huge part of her life. One evening at Holy Family School PTA meeting, the talk was of the lack of after-school activities. And one of the dads stood up and said, "Well, I think Ms. O'Connor is starting a drama club, right?" And Mom thought to herself, "I am." And then another mom, Claire Riley, stood up and announced, "Yes, she is, and I'm going to be her assistant director." And the Holy Family Dramatics Club was born. At the first meeting, 300 students showed up. Lenka brought her Actor Studio tools and skills, and she taught us techniques and theater games, and a bunch of wonderful moms and dads pitched in, expanding the scripts to accommodate to over 100 students eager to perform. Mom directed a big musical every spring for the next 6 years. This grew into the Westchester Young Actors Theater, Wyatt, where under the direction and guidance of Lenka and Rosemary Foley and Al Chompy, us kids wrote many of our own plays and reviews, and Wyatt lived on for the next decade. You know, Mom once said to me that after all, it's just all the wonderful parts she'd played, all the greats she'd worked with, what brought her the most joy, what has meant the most to her was working with children. And she said if she could go back and do it all again, she'd teach. And some of her sweetest memories were of the days that she and Dad spent in Roxbury writing their book, Kids Take the Stage, helping young people discover the creative outlet of theater. Once in LA, working on Dan Petrie's film Lifeguard, Dan, an old friend and colleague, he told her that back in the 50s, he'd wanted to cast her in so many TV roles, but the network wouldn't let him. She'd been blacklisted and she had no idea. She just figured that at that time in the 50s that she just wasn't that good an actress. But she never dwelled on that. She always moved forward. She taught theater and games to young people. When she and Dad moved to Roxbury, Connecticut, at the Young Angels with Marla, at Samina's Seven Angels Theater, and at the Chapag School. And she never stopped performing. But I think performing for her was really sharing, because she loved people, engaging with people. She ignited enthusiasm in people, and people were drawn to her. And we, her children, well, we learned early on that, yeah, she was our mom, and she was a great mom. But we shared her with the world. And she brought the world to us. Varied, extraordinary people with new ideas, just vital, righteous causes. Her co-actors became our playmates. Her summer and regional theater were our adventures. Her dressing rooms were our playrooms. People loved us because they loved her. And she leaves us, her children, with sweet, sweet memories, just cross-country vacations in the station wagon, and exciting visits with cousins, 29 Palms, Iowa City, trips to Lake Powell and camping in Maine, big dinners in the big dining room in New Rochelle, and early anti-war gatherings at Richard Kiley's house, and local civil rights marches, and dear family friends in Largemont, LA, New England, Colorado. We could always depend on Lenka and Dan. They showed up. And that is an amazing privilege to grow up with. And her delight with her grandchildren knew no end. Tanya, Tasha, Nico, Daniel, Lindsay, JD, Hannah. And her great-grandchildren, Echo, Alea, Nolan, Aiden, Kyle, Una, Zach, Joseph, David, Mary, Louisa. Now, during the last 5 years or so, Kevin, her oldest son, he stayed downstairs at her house in Roxbury. He cared for Mom with selfless love and attention. And when her needs increased, there were nurses, skilled, compassionate people who loved her. Laura, her longtime morning nurse, once said, "It's so nice to wake her in the morning. Her eyes just light up and her smile just brightens her room." Whoever taught history, that history class where she wrote across the exam page, "The answer is love," they should have given her an A. She taught me to swim, to sing, to cook, to sew, to play jacks, to act. And just by being who she was, she taught me how to love. And when she died, in those wee hours of the morning, I'm not making this up, the expression on her face, it was that settled, aware, concentrated expression that one sees on an actor's face in the wings before an entrance. The blocking all secure, the lines solid in her head, the week of previews completed, and finally, the opening. Settled, secure. I think she was... she was just listening for her cue. Okay, so you guys, we have a small film that we want to share with you. It's glimpses of Lenka's acting and teaching life. So, Nico?
I was in eighth grade, and the last period of the class, oh, she was terrific. Miss Smith,
yeah,
her name. And during the last period of the week, she would take us all down to the auditorium.
Auditorium.
We called it the auditorium class. And she would give us, before then, we knew we were going to go down, she would let us separate into little groups of about two or three or four kids, and some would go into the cloakroom and some into the little nurse's office, some out in the hall and different places to make up a skit to do for each other. Mm-hmm. And then we went down to the auditorium and she would, you know, we'd get in line and we'd do our skits for each other. And there were no comments or anything like that. My college roommate and I had come during the summer. We had taken, it was during the war. We just took the summer for New York, and we're standing on 42nd Street and Times Square, and we parked ourselves next to a policeman. Mm-hmm. And it was packed with people, with service people and so on. And the war in Europe was announced that it was over, and we stood there. And we watched all the lights turn on all those big signs all over Times Square. And we saw everybody hugging each other and forming conga lines and everything. And then the other time that I think is like that was, got into a USO show, a production of Kiss and Tell. And by then the war in Europe was over, but the war in Japan was still going on. And we were with a whole bunch of servicemen. We finally got on a ship and then we got to Pearl Harbor, and they showed us the rooms, we saw the battleships and so on, and the sirens went on and everything, and the war was over. The war with Japan was over, and we were right there, and we got on the bus and drove up to the Pali Pass, and everybody was hugging. I mean, can you imagine being a kid, a 19-year-old kid, mm-hmm. and being in those two spots at the most significant historical moments? People were just hugging and kissing and so grateful, you know. Right. I mean, they were just falling on the floor and praying and thanking. And it was, oh, I wish everyone could have that experience. Mm-hmm. They'd never let war happen again. Elia Kazan and Cheryl Crawford decided to start this. Kazan had worked with Strasberg way back in the early days of, I forgot the group. The group theater. And so he invited him to come in. A private moment, this was Lee's invention, mm-hmm. Because he said actors have to know how to be private on stage, mm-hmm. so that they can reveal to people what they really are like, or what their feelings really are. And I was alone in the house for the first time in years. I was just had never, you know, when you have kids, you're not alone. And it was all mine. And I couldn't believe it. So I did the potatoes and I started some music. And I love, my mother was Hungarian, and so I love Hungarian music. And so I turned on this Hungarian Rhapsody. And I started to peel the potatoes in rhythm, and I couldn't help it. I just had to get up and dance. And I danced all over the living room and the stairs and everything. And I finally wound up where the music goes, broom, bong, da-da, you know. And I did a huge, big pratfall because a neighbor had taught me how to do it. And so I did this big pratfall on the couch. And what happened was that I decided to do this, to do it in the private moment. And I brought the music in, and I did the dancing, and I did the huge pratfall. I laid a lot of pillows there, and they just roared. And the beauty part of it was, the part that thrilled me the most was, so many people came up to me afterward, after the session, you know, and said, you know, I do that too. Or they said, you know, I dance on elevators, or, you know, I sing. Isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
So that's what the actor's job is.
That's what it is.
We're releasing each other, mm-hmm. to realize we're all the same human beings with the mm-hmm. same foibles and the same goodness.
Mm-hmm. What do you find yourself thinking before you step on stage on opening night?
I want to die. I think I'll go home, because that moment when you're, if you've got a door to enter through or something like that, is so terrifying. And something happens, you walk through that door and it disappears. Mm-hmm. Then you have to serve the play. Arthur Penn was directing. I loved him so, and he was wonderful. The only thing that drove me crazy was that his little things that he would say to the actors were so quiet that I couldn't hear him, and I wanted to know what he was saying to everybody.
Of course.
I'm coming.
Then did a rainbow for the rainy days. Dreamed of the heroes on the blue side.
That's the one. That's the one.
Then is the devil in the dark and sad. Captured the rainbow with a thousand.
can I speak to you?
Sure, go right ahead.
Are you the man who's looking for someone?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, I was.
Someone looking for $50?
That's right.
He said for you to come with me, will you?
He said, who's he?
Are you coming?
Yeah.
Because I was nursing him. And so what happened was that as we were filming, because I had to go down to New Orleans, and my mother came and took care of Kevin, the new baby.
Well, you know, were shooting in New Orleans.
And we're shooting in New Orleans, and I had, you know, gotten a lot of milk for him and stuff like that. But I kept changing size, you know, because I'm still, my body is still ready to nurse the baby.
And, by the hour.
Yeah, and not only that, but leaking. Mm-hmm. So they had to keep redoing it. Finally, he had to put a leather jacket on me.
Lonely Ruth Gates reporting. No pledge nonsense. It's just Ruthie and Mary between us now. Well, Ruth, I'm afraid I'm going to have to ask for your pin.
But Mary, I'll pay them. It's just a question of a little time.
No, it isn't that. Well, some of the girls feel it's a black mark against the house. I wish there was something I could do. My hands are tied. But now we don't want you to feel like a stranger. Well, we'd like you to come to dinner sometimes. We'd so love to see you.
I gotta go to 4th Street. Get names.
Oh, no, you don't have to do that now. You look so tired. Why don't you go to bed and get a good night's rest? And now there's absolutely no rush about your moving out. You'll find a place in a few days.
What are you doing here?
Joe, who is this nice-looking young man?
He's nobody. My partner. Strebeck, introduce yourself to my grandmother.
What a pleasant surprise. Granny Friday.
Not that it's any of your business. She's my maternal grandmother. Her name is Mundy.
Why don't we all discuss this over dinner? It's my birthday. We're going to the Brown Derby. Do join us, Detective Swayback.
Strebeck, pep. Granny, I don't think it's such a good idea.
Why not, Joe?
Yeah, Joe, why not?
I've invited someone already to join us, and you don't really know her. She's a...
Her? Joe, you have a date? Oh, I'm so proud.
Well, in that case, it looks like I have a date, too. Granny Mundy, may I escort you to Joe's car?
I'd be privileged, Detective Stockard.
I was so scared and so nervous, and at the dress rehearsal I screwed it up because it was just a two-character play and the scenes were so similar, you know, and I think I screwed up the ending, but Marla was wonderful. She was just so giving and ready and everything. I drove to the theater on the opening night, and it's the only time I can remember thinking, if I just could drive the car into a tree, I wouldn't have to do this show tonight. I was so scared.
Love the lifeline with hand quick and strong. Why do you tarry while linger so long?
Mrs. Stiles?
See when she is sinking.
Mrs. Gray Stiles? Hello?
And out with lifeboat.
Mrs.
Throw out the lifeline.
Excuse me, the door was open and I...
And away, yay.
Throw Mrs.
out the lifeline. Someone is sinking today.
Oh, I'm sorry, guys. I'm so sorry I startled you, Mrs. Stiles. I did knock. Daddy sent you home today. How are you doing?
Honey.
You know, when they told me you lived way up here in the mountains, I didn't fully appreciate. I mean, the roads. I wasn't sure my car.
Honey, I can see your lips moving, so I know you're talking, but I can't hear a blessed word you're saying. And I ain't gone deep, if that's what you're thinking. It's this thing here. I was hoping that me and the Good News Quartet could drown out that confounded racket.
Well, here, let me help you.
I can do it.
Hi, I'm Gloria Wigmore. Well, you probably don't remember, but we met at the hospital.
Yeah, I remember. What do you think? I'm senile?
No, of course not.
You probably think I'm a little daffy, too, old prune like me wearing one of these things. But it wasn't none of my doing. It was that Bernice Wallace. My roommate there at the hospital. You met her last week, or don't you remember?
Oh, yes, of course.
Yeah. Well, she died yesterday.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't know.
No, why is sorry? She was 87 years old. Me, I'm 90.
Yes, I know.
Yeah.
Mrs. Stiles, is there anyone here with you?
I do believe you are.
This was a piece of my wedding dress. Forward laughter and tenderness. And this ring was made color of
beautiful boy walked by. Oh God, he was such a sweet looking boy. No more than 17 or 18. He was a hippie type, you know, with the earrings and the beads, and his hair was long and blonde, and he was coming down the street, like right at me. I mean, like just coming right out of the blue, right for me. And I saw that he was smiling. And I knew that he was smiling at me. Really me, little old me inside here, me. And I turned away. And I cursed him under my breath, and I called him a hippie to myself, like there was something wrong in being them. I was ashamed. I was ashamed because I didn't deserve to be smiled at. And then I looked up and I saw that he was still coming, and I tried to smile back, but I saw that he had caught my shame, that he knew it wasn't real, that I was just pretending. And his face grew cold, and he just passed by. Oh God, I wanted to reach out I wanted to run on and I wanted to tell him that I was happy that he smiled at me because he's young and beautiful and it's nice to be young and beautiful and not like I
am. At the Holy Family School and the stage used to be the
cafeteria.
The gym. Yeah. And anyway, we were supposed to have a little fire going. Yeah. And I was back there with the one light standing there, you know, and one of the girls came running back and she said, Miss O'Connor, the fireplace doesn't work. I saw that it wasn't working. Mm. And so I called this girl that was helping the light. I said, run back and this is how you do it. And they crawled on in the back and they fixed the fireplace and it made it work again. And she came back through the whole auditorium, back to the light to me. And I said, nice work. And she said, have we got a team or have we got a team? I tell you, that just tells you that's like a nutshell of the wonder of working with kids in theater.
Yeah, yeah.
God bless everyone who would please do that.
We're on our way over to the Seven Angels Theater, which Samina De Laurentiis started. I think there's a goodness in all human beings, and I also think that all kids love to act. I mean, this is how we learn. They play pretend when they're little. They're great actors when they're little. What we want is to grab their imaginations and nurture that so that they'll really like the idea of doing stories and of performing them for each other and for other people.
This is what we call mobile statuary. Okay, shall we try it? I took lessons from at the Actor Studio from a master of mime by the name of Etienne Decroux, who taught Marcel Marceau and John Ribeiro. Have you heard of those guys that do mime? And one of the things that he said is you do mobile statuary, which is that you first move the eyes and the head and the shoulders. So it's pick a point. And you just gradually keep involving your whole body until your whole body is turned around, you know, as far as you can. Now, what I wanted to adapt that movement, the mobile statuary, into a feeling, or at least, so that if I give you each a phrase, and you say it, it's sort of like building up the five W's, but this time we'll see if we can build it up with behavior.
And this is really how my association with Marla came about. Dan and I were writing the first volume of this.
Yes.
And I told her about it. She said, well, I used to be a proofreader. Want me to go? And she started proofreading it and got so interested. And then so that's how we began working together. And then I said, well, you know, I'm doing some theater over at Seven Angels. And then she decided to join me. And then that's how we started that theater company.
Oh. Yeah. And then grew up.
Yeah.
And started a theater company and they named it after you.
Yeah. One of them, Mandy Thompson. Mm-hmm. Started when she was in about fourth grade or so, and was in it all through grade school and high school, and then she went to Emerson and graduated, and then started the Lenka Peterson Players. I would say that the important thing is to remember that what you are doing as an actor is revealing people to themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Is letting them find out about themselves, what human beings are really doing and really thinking and really finding. And actors can do that, and audiences can identify. I think, you know, actors ought to act like they're putting their arm around the side of the house and around the back and including and saying, all of us are doing this together.
Yeah.
And if they just realize that theater can release people from their fears and their needs and can help them to identify with other people and identify themselves. I just want theater to be used more to help. People
Thank
need
you.
To know that they can identify with each other.
Thank
We're
you.
All,
That's a,
all one.
Thank you so much for talking.
Thank you.
I wish we had more time.
I love you so
much. I love you too, Mom.
Wow. That was beautiful.
That was a wow.
That was a wow. I know, between.
Gorgeous. Thank you all for putting that together. Oh, fabulous.
I'll take a tissue moment if we need before we proceed. I would like to just keep it moving and bring up our next speaker. We're going to continue along with Lenka's son, Brian.
Thank you, Nico.
You're welcome.
One time when I was a teenager, a friend asked me, what's it like to have an actress for a mom? And I replied, pretty strange. But upon reflection, I realized that this was not really true. I was just giving the answer I thought was expected. Actually, to me, it was normal. I knew it was different from other moms, but I didn't have one of those. I had her. Here are some of the things that were normal for us. Her answering service, as all actors had before answering machines were invented. The service would call with audition appointments and film shoot call times, and we could call them and leave messages for mom to pick up from wherever she was calling in from that day. But sometimes work people would call the house directly. Often it was from one of the many soap operas she worked on. My favorite was when I answered and it was someone from one of the soaps and I was able to call out, hey mom, someone from another world is on the phone. I guess other moms don't get recognized in every Howard Johnson's we ate at on our family road trips. Aren't you so-and-so from Search for Tomorrow? My favorite was the time she said, yes. And the person replied, I thought so. You look alike. I guess other moms don't give endless stacks of old scripts to draw on the back of the pages. I guess other moms don't watch TV with you and call out during practically every program, there's Jane, or, oh, look, there's Lonnie. I'm so glad he's working. I guess other moms don't let you sit in her dressing room and draw while she was on stage. On the day she'd bring us to the theater when she was in a play on Broadway, she would always stop and talk to one of the mounted police that patrolled the theater district. And she would always have sugar cubes for us to feed to the horse. It was always the same friendly cop. Many years later, just by coincidence, I met the son of that cop. Small world. But it was a mixed blessing. Like any working mother, a lot of the time she wasn't home. But I sensed that she loved to be home and that she was conflicted about splitting her time between her career and her home life. And thinking back, I noticed something odd about her career. In 1957, she was in a Broadway play called Look Homeward Angel. In 1960, she was in a Broadway play called All the Way Home. In 1974, she was in an off-Broadway play called Leaving Home. She was in an off-Broadway play called Home, a Future Soap. She was even in a movie called Homer. Was the world telling her something? Or is it just me? I don't know. What I do know is that when she was home, she was an amazing mom. She was so active in introducing us to wonderful culture. For instance, she got us a little record player and a box set of Leonard Bernstein's Young People's Concerts, Mussorgsky's The Great Gates of Kiev, and Carnival of the Animals by Sanson were burned into my memory at an early age. And in the summer, she would pack all of us and as many neighborhood kids that would fit into the station wagon and drag us and drive us to Saxon Woods Pool or Jones Beach. There were so many kids in that station wagon that if it were today, she'd get arrested immediately. Like any married couple, she and Dad would argue. And it was often over something that we broke or that we weren't supposed to use. The argument that is most vivid to me was the one she ended by finally saying in a more vehement tone than I had ever heard her use, "People are more important than things." She and Dad would take us on many road trips in the old station wagon, and we would sing and play games. But my most treasured memory from those trips is when she would read to us. There were the wonderful classic children's books, of course, like The Secret Garden and The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. But not only children's books. Even though we were kids, I remember so vividly The Diamond as Big as the Ritz by F. Scott Fitzgerald, Big Blonde by Dorothy Parker, and A Passion in the Desert by Balzac. And then there were the school plays she directed, first at Holy Family Dramatics Club when we were in grade school, and later Wyatt, Westchester Young Actors Theater, when we were in high school. In the Holy Family plays, she and Claire Riley would rewrite the script so that every kid who wanted to be in it got a part. Captain Von Trapp had at least 14 children. In Annie, Get Your Gun, not only were Annie, Oakley, and Sitting Bull characters, but also Calamity Jane and Geronimo. She and Claire wrote the character of Tokyo Rose into South Pacific to have an extra role for a deserving kid. Susie Barrett, if I remember correctly. In Wyatt, she and Rosemary Foley and Al Ciampi would create amazing original shows and even let us write and direct our own, and no one was excluded. All were welcomed, even if they only wanted to sit in the back and watch. So whether she was at home or off working, she lived life with passion and relish. I think if I had to sum up her attitude towards life in one quote, it would be a line from the movie Jeffrey. She had a small part as a lady in the church where Nathan Lane was the priest. Her line was, "I think the only real sin is the refusal of joy." That's Mom all the way. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you very much, Brian. That was wonderful. So we'll continue with Lenka's children. And next up, we have her son, Darren.
Thanks very much, Nico. Since Mom died on September 24th, I've really enjoyed reading the messages coming in from family and friends and describing the fond memories of her. And they made me think about the essence of her character. I think you can see that character evinced in a lot of the productions that she was in, many of which we saw in the presentation a while ago. One that struck me was the scene from Take Care of My Little Girl. I watched the whole movie a couple of weeks ago. Mom portrayed Ruth Gates. This was a girl who wanted so much to be accepted into a sorority that the desire just consumed her. Now, everybody in this Zoom session knows Lenka, and you know that Lenka would not have been worried in the least about not being accepted in a sorority. Lenka definitely was not Ruth Gates. But does anybody doubt that she became Ruth Gates in that movie? It shows the genuine depth of her craft, but it shows more than that. She became Ruth Gates because she had complete empathy for her, Ruth, and embraced Ruth's motivations. I think it's empathy that really defined her. She needed hardly any time to identify and empathize with anyone she met. Lenka would simply be incapable of relating to the concept of Schadenfreude. She wanted to bring the best out with her own kids, and she wanted to bring the best out with everybody else's kids as well. She'd take a child, identify with what made them tick, and make them shine. So whether it was Lenka Isaacson as a girl, Lenka Peterson as an actor and teacher, Lenka O'Connor as the family pulse and loyal friend, Lenka really embodied the very best in human character. Thanks all for joining us today. And to remember Lenka, thanks for your prayers for her eternal soul. God bless. Back to you, Nico.
Thank you very much, Darren. That was wonderful. So I guess we'll continue along with the children. Next, we're going to hear from your son, Sean. May I have to unmute? There you are. Okay.
Thank you, Nico, very much. And thank you, everybody. I'm unmuted. And it's great to be here. I hold in my hand a pan for making Swedish pancakes. And if you want to know what a great Sunday morning was, it was waking up and having those, and her recipe was the best. I recommend it, but a wonderful gift from her. And she loved being around people, of course, and having a lot of people over to the house, either for a meal or for a weekend. And it was a very colorful kind of carousel of interesting people from all walks of life. And she was often a shoulder to cry on for anyone who was going through a rough time. And once she was having a heart-to-heart with someone, and that person thanked her for her words of comfort, and Mom said, well, that's why we're here on earth, to help other people. And I try to keep those words with me, and I thank you, Mom, for that, and so many gifts, and thank you all very much. And now there's going to be a kind of a photo montage of her and her life with us and beyond. Thank you.
We're on our way over to the Seven Angels Theater, which Samina De Laurentiis started. I think there's a goodness in all human beings, and I also think that all kids love to act. I mean, this is how we learn. They play pretend when they're little. They're great actors when they're little. What we want is to grab their imaginations and nurture that so that they'll really like the idea of doing stories and of performing them for each other and for other people.
What I'd like to do is, I will start because I'm crazy, and what I'd like to do is go around the circle and just give your first name and some kind of gesture. Either one that you think is like you, or like something you can't stand, or that you would like to be like, or something like that. Just, I say, I am Lenka, and I'll do it twice. Lenka, okay?
I am Lenka.
No, you say your own name.
Oh, okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You don't know what to expect, so it's hard to know what to look forward to. So I think naming that you look forward to is just trying to live each moment of this next year by itself and fill it with as much wonder, love, understanding, and encouragement as possible, and awareness. And just to not worry about the moment before, but to worry about the moment to come. Try to look through.
That was beautiful, Sean. Thank you so much. So we're going to continue along with the sons and daughters-in-law. First up, if you're ready, we have my mom, Eileen O'Connor. So
okay, and I unmuted myself.
And there she is.
Yeah, and I'm glad I can't see myself right now. You know, this is a hard act to follow, and I'll have to say, though, that I remember meeting a very charming, effusive woman. We're talking some 40 years ago now. And she welcomed me and my three little middle school children into her home and into her heart. You know, there was no holding back with her. And as you probably know, and I've been hearing, you know, she had a gracious way of making everybody feel as though they were the center of her attention. You know, and, you know, I'm glad to hear that as a theme here. And I don't know how many times I must have worn her down with, you know, my laments about my life and my work and my struggles. She was patient. She listened to it all. But I just have to say the highlight for me, and I'm sure my kids will agree, was that the wonderful, magical times that she gave us at Roxbury. And she and Dad created a world that we hadn't known, you know, when we first became involved. And she, you know, Roxbury was true magic for all of us. And I remember especially Christmas. And at Christmas, you know, you could just see the ornaments, you could see the lights, you could see the lights, you know, going out into the woods beyond, you know. And I just remember how she loved playing, you know, singing the Christmas carols, and the whole family, you know, being down by the piano and listening. And so my hope, you know, and I can't top the O'Connors and the wonderful mother they had and the wonderful way they're celebrating her life. But, you know, I hope that she is still having chances on the other side now to, you know, be having those wonderful Christmas carols, and that she's still drinking the glug, and that, you know, I want to thank her so much for sharing her family with me, and, you know, not just sharing herself and her love, but her son and her wonderful family. So I'm going to stop at that and let others speak about what they know of Lenka, but she was magic to all of us. So thank you, Lenka, and we miss you.
Thank you, Mom. Yes, yes, she was pure magic. I think we all know that now. Next up, we have Doug Stern, Lenka's husband. If you're ready here online here, give you a second. You might be muted. I did mute everybody at one point.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can.
Great. Okay. Hello. I first encountered Lenka in 1983 after I had seriously dated Glennis for around a year and a half. Lenka was incredibly warm, welcoming, humorous, and a wonderful conversationalist. Roughly a year later, Glennis and I told Lenka and Dan of our plan to marry. And I must say that at the time, I simply marveled at the fact that although I was 35, jobless, and without any tangible employment opportunities, Lenka and Dan never once subjected Glennis or me to any form of interrogation regarding my future prospects. Instead, they were unconditionally prepared to graciously welcome me into their family. It became readily apparent to me that Lenka and Dan didn't traffic in, nor were they inhibited by any form of bourgeois baggage. Indeed, Lenka was a serious outlier that was multiple steps ahead of her generational cohort. 7 decades ago, when Lenka and Dan moved to New York to pursue their respective careers, they chose to set up their family's household in a racially and economically diverse neighborhood. They were both always fierce advocates of social justice. Some decades later, Lenka was one of the early buyers of a hybrid car. When queried about her choice, she replied that it made simple sense. It was both cleaner to the environment and cheaper to drive. Throughout her life, Lenka manifested a prodigious level of creative energy and spirit. She was what one would characterize as a courageous optimist. How else could she have simultaneously developed a substantial career while raising 5 children? And then, midway through it all, she decided to devote herself to teaching children the art of acting. Later, in collaboration with Dan, Lenka even found the time to document her teaching methods in a well-received book. Over the years, I've witnessed many testimonials from Lenka's students around the impact that she had on their development as teenagers, and on their lives as a whole. But in the context of Lenka's myriad of accomplishments and demonstrated qualities over a very full life, what stands out the most for me is that she was simply one of the most generous and kind individuals that I've ever known. I sometimes find myself regretting that my younger self never had the benefit of being counted as one of Lenka's students. But then I simply focus on the fact that I had the great privilege of hanging out with this extraordinary person over the span of almost 40 years. Like so many others, I will miss her very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Doug. Wonderful. Now we're going to move forward to grandchildren. I guess we'll start with my oldest sister, if she's prepared. I know, Tanya.
Hi.
There we are. Okay, Tanya, take it away.
So, hi. I wanted to add one thing about the glug on Christmas was that I was too young most of the time to ever partake, but I remember the Christmas carols got a lot more entertaining after the glug was around, so appreciate that. And I was so blessed to have Lenka come into my life and be my grandmother. And this was just an incident, a story that kind of captures a lot of her in so many ways. So here goes. It was just Lenka and I on this afternoon, and we were going on a little car ride. I don't know if we were headed to the store or just for a chat, but I was so thrilled to be there with her by her side to get some one-on-one time. She was my grandma now and easily put all my other grandmas to shame. Maybe all the grandmas in time, probably. It was just her nature to treat you like a VIP, and we never had to earn it. It was just her nature. So it was on this afternoon in the car, and I was just being brilliant to her. I was her sole focus, and you know, she was driving, but somehow her hands were on the wheel, but her face was directly at me the whole time. She was passionate, and she knew only one way to be. And even though she was steering the car along these quaint, winding Roxbury roads, she seemed to have complete faith that the car could handle it on its own without much of her own help. So it took my 10-year-old instincts at the time, they kicked in, and I figured if I just looked forward at the road, maybe she would get the idea that that's what you should do in a car also. So I hoped and I looked forward, but I was hoping she would catch on to her mistake and maybe go back to regular driving like most people do. They listen to you and kind of look at you sideways. But Lenka, when she listens, she's committed fully. But the ride, it felt like an adventure already, but then she took a complete detour on me. And then she, for the first time, looked at the road seriously and said to me, "We have to find our dog. Tanya, do you see him on the side? We need to find him." And I was thinking, I don't think we have a dog. And I don't think there's a dog in Roxbury. And I sat there, and then it just hit me that Lenka was taking the opportunity, like she does, to teach. And we were in the middle of an impromptu acting class, bam, all of a sudden. So it was on these little narrow roads that we continued searching for that dear, sweet dog of ours. We searched the hills. There was a creek and a steep cliff on one side. We searched the side. And I remember looking at any of the cars that came up behind us that had the unfortunate timing to come up behind us, because Lenka just wave them aside, go past us, we're busy, we're desperate. And I could see their faces because they would have to cross this double yellow line. And it was curves up ahead. They had no idea what was coming, but they were being pushed aside by us. And thankfully, the only tragedy that day was us losing our dog. There was no other incident that evening. And I thought Lenka's driving guardian angels kept its extremely time-consuming job that day. Sorry, I just want to get this story. And it was such an exhilarating and terrifying afternoon for me, Lenka and I on a secret mission. We returned to the Roxbury house without anyone ever even asking us what happened. And only years later did I really get how brilliant of an afternoon I had had with her. She took me into her world, if only for a minute, and I am forever blessed from it. Thank you.
Well, that's great. I'm going to option and buy the movie rights for the story of that day. I love it. I know it's hard to even find words to describe Lenka. You know, I was thinking in my head, and I spent like a half an hour putting together adjectives. And it just didn't even measure up. It doesn't even compare to knowing her. And you know, in my years as an actor, I met so many people in the city, and their reaction was always the same. Lenka's your grandmother. We love her. I mean, she's everybody's favorite person. No offense to all my relatives here. I love all of you, but I mean, just the general consensus from everyone is just she's just magical. You know. So I'm gonna keep moving Fry Meltdown. I think my brother Danny O'Connor is going to say something. I have him on my list. There he is. Well, Tanya, that grandma must have had a really good guardian angel, because I actually still have the car here that she was probably driving during that story, and it's got quite a few dents on it. So I don't know when exactly those happened, but no injuries, thanks be to God. Anyway, as long as I can remember, Grandma Lenka was always one of my favorite people to visit. I see that's a memory I share with a lot of you here, but thankfully with age, I became a little more graceful with how exactly to show that affection, because I vividly recall getting in big trouble a number of times for insisting that I and only I was the one who got to sit next to Grandma at dinner when we were over at Roxbury. And I'm sure Lindsay and I had a lot of battles about that. But truly, as I grew up, and I mean this in complete seriousness, Grandma was always one of those people that I could keep in mind as an example to follow, when always full of life, always kind, always positive, always loving. So if I was ever tempted to be rude or even boring, I could just think to myself, what would Grandma Lenka do? And that would always set me straight. And that's also the norm, what would Grandma Lenka do? That's also really helpful if I'm ever tempted to be honest. Because if one of my undergraduate students says like the most absurd thing imaginable, I can just channel my inner Grandma Lenka and I can find something positive to say about that. There's always something, and Grandma Lenka taught me that. But anyway, I'm very happy that I got to spend a lot of time with Grandma in the early 2010s when I was studying at grad school in Connecticut before I got an apartment there. So I spent a lot of overnights there at Roxbury and had a lot of deep conversations with Grandma, spiritual ones as well. And even if she and I weren't always on the exact same page with all those things, it was great talking to her. And I know that she loved God very much, and I know that God loves her very much. So we're praying for her. Please, I ask everyone of this to also pray for her until we all meet again on the other side. And before I hand it over back to Nico, just a couple of Grandma's great-grandchildren want to say a quick hello.
Hello.
Okay, love you, Grandma. Yeah, okay. God bless.
Wow, I don't think we're ready for that much cuteness in one shot, huh? Hey, everybody. Oh, I missed them so much. All right. I just want to look at them for a few more moments. Okay, so I guess we'll continue with grandchildren. I have Lindsay listed with Lindsay. You ready? Hi.
Thanks, Nico.
You're welcome.
Hi, everyone. To be in my Grandma Lenka's life was to get very used to compliments. Lots and lots of compliments. And you might think that being told you were wonderful would give you a big head or make you wonder whether the person was insincere. But my Grandma Lenka had a way of making her true feelings known. In the summer of 2009, on my high school graduation, I remember that I didn't even have to look out into the audience to see her blonde head when I entered the room to know that she was there. There was a hush over the audience with many parents awaiting their children's pivotal moment. And Lenka had scored a front row seat and was already making her presence very much felt through the hush with an, oh, for each girl that she had no connection to other than me, who was entering. But woe to the girl whose dress didn't flatter her more generously proportioned figure. There was an oh. When my grandma started to lose her memory, she didn't get sour or irritated. During visits, when she would lose the thread of the conversation, she would quite literally start to sing. I wanted to share a story from the last year of her life, her 95th birthday, which was just a little over a year ago. We were living, I'm living in Connecticut, so I had the chance to go visit her, and we were sitting in her living room drinking rosé. The nice thing about losing your memory is that you can conveniently forget when people have just said that they will pass on wine. Would you like some? Are you sure? Are you very sure? And I was worn down enough that I relented and was glad that I did. Just then a knock sounded at the door. It was a woman with a heaping bouquet of flowers who introduced herself as the local florist with a delivery for the resident. Of the name and number in the flowers weren't familiar to me, but I figured it was one of Grandma Lenka's cherished friends. When I showed her the card, I could see that as she took it in, she didn't recognize the name either. I imagined how maddened and ashamed I might feel reading the name of a person this close to me and drawing a blank. I definitely wouldn't have wanted to call them up and reveal myself. But my Grandma Lenka wasn't one to suffer from pride. With a twinkle in her eye, she called up the number on the card right then. And when the tone for the answering machine sounded, she said after the beep, "I hope you have a wonderful, wonderful life." We were only a little deeper into the rosé when another knock sounded at the door. It was the florist again, looking devastated. She needed the flowers back, she said. She had made a mistake with the delivery. The bouquet had been meant for the woman whose name was on the card. All along, she really had been a stranger, and my Grandma Lenka had wished her a wonderful life. Now, something in that accidental message she delivered, making someone she had never met feel acknowledged and relished. The way she continued reaching out into life with joy and fearlessness, even when life started to shrink away from her, felt reflective of Lenka. Thank you.
Thank you. That was beautiful. So we're going to move forward. Did any other grandchildren want to, I don't want to put anyone on the spot. If anyone, before we move forward. Okay. Well, I have in my agenda next, we have Lenka's nephews and nieces on the list of speakers. And first up, I have Brian and Susan. Are they here and ready to join the party? Unmute and tell a story? Everyone is muted, so you'll have to unmute yourself, which is on the bottom left corner of your screen, if you want to.
Okay, give me a break.
There we are, okay.
Well, this is Brian, and I love thinking about Aunt Lenka. I've always enjoyed our visits there. I've heard a lot of neat words applied to her today. Joy, fearlessness, grace, giving. I just wanted to give you one example of some of those things thrown together. About 15 years ago, Susan and I came up and visited for Thanksgiving. And we came in and it was getting dark and Aunt Lenka, not wanting us to not have a good time, insisted that we go down and get into that sauna and we jump into the lake and have a swim. And I had just come from outside and walked down to the lake before coming up into the house on a tour from my cousins who were bragging about their wonderful lake and so on. And so when she suggested that we go down there and get in the sauna and jump in the lake, I mentioned to her, but Aunt Lenka, you know, there's a half inch of ice on that lake down there. And she looks at me with those piercing, wonderful blue eyes and says, "And your point is?" And that's the end of my story.
And it's a wonderful ending to it.
Lenka has been my role model for my... some years later, I told her that, and she just looked at me and she said, "Me?" And then I had so much fun telling her how she had affected my life, how she had helped me in so many occasions. I met Lenka 53 years ago in New Rochelle when Brian and I came to visit, and we were still dating. And her warmth, her acceptance of me, of course, her ability to listen. So it was, and she enjoyed listening, her varied interest, and of course, her humor were captivating from day one. And she made me feel, which was really special, like a part of the family before I was. She had a special gift, and she shared it freely with so many people. And yet, every time I was with her, she had a way of always making me feel special. Lenka was simply the very best, and I shall treasure the moments and the times with her and try to keep applying to them in my life. She was just so special. Thank you.
You're welcome. That was great. More in this room?
Well, I'm in the same room, and I'm...
Bring it on. I have a list of people. I don't know if I have to announce anyone, or you're just going to come forward. Let's do you. Love it.
Thank you, Nico. I'm going to try to get through this if I can. Lenka might be surprised to know that she also was my role model. She was my hero. She taught me three very important things, many things, but three most important. The importance and joy of boundless laughter, the love of the theater, and she was a master at facilitating the dinner conversation in big family gatherings. An example of the first one I'll never forget, and Kevin will remember this as well. Years ago, 40 years ago or so, she came out to California for lots of job opportunities, jobs working in sitcoms and getting lots of jobs out in California. So she stayed at Oakwood Gardens in Burbank. And, but as luck would have it, as soon as she arrived, she came down with a case of Bell's palsy, which many of you may know is a paralysis of one side of the face, which rendered her strikingly strange looking, to put it mildly. And many actresses would get very angry at that, depressed, fall into despair. You know, here they are. She was on the verge of middle age, but facing a lot of job opportunities, which were robbed from her because she lost the feeling and control in one side of her face. But not Lenka. She took that as an opportunity to entertain us and have fun and find the humor in it. And so Kevin will remember, I treated her to tacos one night, and she proceeded to try to eat them, and the taco sauce was drooling down one side of her face. And so she stood up from the table and walked around the room and did her impression of Quasimodo. And we were in absolute stitches. So it was a really very valuable lesson that I learned, that when difficult times come, you make the best of it and you find the humor in it. And I'll never forget that. Of course, her love of the theater. I had the great blessing to see her do Mrs. Minter in LA, and I traveled to Pittsburgh to see her in Quilters, and not once but twice. And then we brought our daughters to go see her in Crazy for You, not once but three times at the Schubert in California, a memory we will always remember. And finally, one of her greatest gifts to me was I would just marvel at how she practiced the art of facilitating a family conversation in a big group at the dinner table so many times there in Roxbury. She was a master at it. It didn't matter whether there were just three of us or 23 of us. She made everyone at the table feel loved and valued, that what they had to say mattered, and that we were all important. And I will never forget that. And it's an especial accomplishment considering that one of the people at that table was Darren. So that was not, just kidding, Darren, you know, I love you. So I shall carry those images and all the cherished memories of all our times together with in my heart forever. And I'm so glad that my dad's brother married her. So thank you.
You're welcome. That's great. So I have next speaking on my list here is Patty Isaacson. And Patty, I do have a photo that you wanted me to share as well.
Yeah, I'll tell you when to pop it up there.
Okay, when? Okay, because we want to keep you center screen. So I
wanted to. David just arrived here in DC from Seattle. I'm happy that he could be here with me for this. So wanted you to see him too. I want to thank you for this opportunity to share a personal reflection on Lenka. You know, she was so many things to me. She was family, and I also want to note three things that I am tremendously grateful to her for. She was a sister. Aunt Lenka loved our father, Peter, her younger brother, and he loved her. Whenever I think of them together and how much they teased and laughed with and cherished each other, I reminded how deeply and dearly I love my sisters, Charlotte and Christina. Thank her for that. She made family. When our mother died, Aunt Lenka came to be with her brother and my sisters and I in the home my sister Charlotte had made for our parents in Silver City, New Mexico. My not yet husband, David, and his 8-year-old daughter, Ingrid, came too. Here is a photo from that time. That's the photo I want to show. Here you go. Thank you. Here's a photo from that time that means so much to me. Aunt Lenka connected immediately with Ingrid, drawing her close in a "we are small, but we are mighty, and we have enormous hearts" way that has forever stayed with me as I've watched Ingrid grow passionately into her own brave and enormous heart that has the space and the desire to hold every living animal on this planet. Aunt Lenka helped me recognize that. And last, she was a loving aunt. Sorry. Aunt Lenka and Uncle Danny took me into their home when, as a freshly college graduated English major, I arrived on their doorstep in New Rochelle to pursue a career in publishing. Now that my own daughter, Zofia, is almost the same age I was then, it is deeply, deeply resonant for me just how much Aunt Lenka supported me with friendship and generosity, sharing advice over pond paddles and friendship with quilters' parties and an ever open ear. How much she supported me during that critical time I was trying to become an adult. I remember her fondly telling me that the best thing about having babies was that they grew up to be people. I want to pay forward that generosity of spirit to my daughter as she becomes a woman with all the gratitude to Aunt Lenka that I cannot express and will forever hold. Much love to my dear cousins.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. So I think next up, I believe okay, lost my order a little bit. I think we have Mike O'Connor.
I'm here.
There we are. Okay.
Can you hear me?
You're on camera. It's all yours.
Thanks, Nico. And thanks, Lenka, for having such a great family and a great bunch of friends that are all here today. And it's been a privilege being a part of this family. You know, everybody today is talking about the warmth and the love and the laughter and the tenderness of Lenka, which we all acknowledge, but I'm here to tell you, she had a tough side as well. In fact, if I didn't know that she, her family was from Hungary, I swear she was a Mick like so many others of us. Because in 1969, I took a little trip around the country and I stopped by their house. And of course, Lenka and Dan, you know, welcomed me in and said, Mike, stay as long as you could. Didn't have much choice on that because my truck broke down in their driveway and I couldn't move it. But regardless, I was staying there. And I remember one day, I got up in the morning and everybody was off doing what they're doing. He says, well, Mike, how'd you sleep? And I said, well, Lenka, you know, everything was fine, but you know, those utility guys were out there with their jackhammers breaking up the street early, early this morning around 6 or 7 o'clock. Now, mind you, I didn't register a complaint. I'm just letting her know, just telling her. And lo and behold, the next morning, I heard the jackhammers again, which I figured, okay, no big deal. It's time to get up. I'm on New York time. I should go with it. And all of a sudden it stopped. And there was this little woman that walked up to this group of street workers that were all between 10 and 12 feet tall and probably half that in their girth. And she looked up at them as if she was looking at the Empire State Building. And she looked at them and I just saw this finger like this go up like this. And I heard a few words like, nephew, California, early, wake him up. And she was pointing up at my window where I was. And so I moved back in the window because I didn't want these guys to see me. And I thought, oh my God. And from that point on, there was no more noise. They didn't come back. And in fact, what they did is I looked the next morning about 7 o'clock and they were standing on the sides of their trucks like this, looking at their watches, waiting for the wuss from California to finally get up and acknowledge the day. So there was a tough side to Lenka that I'm not sure that we all really understood and acknowledged, but she, now granted, she did it lovingly, but whatever she said to those guys, they stopped and they did not continue. There was also a side of her that was the ultimate diplomat. Kathy and I were visiting with her one time when she was living out here and we were talking about police and getting stopped by police. And she told us about the time that she was driving and stopped by police. And by the way, this story reminds me of, I remember when Kevin went to law school, we all knew that Kevin was going to go to law school and figured, yeah, he'll make it through okay. But when Darren decided to go to law school, we were wondering, how in the heck is Darren going to make it through law school? After seeing this, I realized that Lenka, the diplomat, is the one that really trained Darren to get through law school and be the person he's been as a lawyer all these years. She got stopped by a policeman. She was late for an audition or whatever. And the officer went through the whole thing of license, et cetera, ma'am, do you know how fast you're going? And she was sitting in the front of the car squirming like this. And she looked up at the officer and kind of smiled. And he said, ma'am, are you okay? And she goes, I'm fine. I just have diarrhea. And he looked at her and stepped back and said, please go, ma'am. And that was it. So she made it to her audition in time. So just a couple of things about Lenka that in the future, remember that the warm, loving person, she used that warm and loving and tenderness in her diplomacy and her toughness in getting the big guys to stop their noise early in the morning. So thanks, Lenka, and thanks to the entire O'Connor clan and Isaacsons and everybody else. All right, Nico, thanks.
All right, you're welcome. So that's the O'Connor Isaacson clan speaking list that I have so far. We were going to go to some friends, unless there's someone I missed. I apologize. I know there's a lot of emails going around. So good to go. All right. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I'm moving on to some friends now. Next up, we have Rosemary Foley. She's going to share a story with us. Bottom left corner is where you hit the unmute.
Did I start?
There we go.
Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Okay. Lenka and I put plays together, invented them, crazy and wild plays. And she went with them all. And we had a great time. And Lenka and I would go after the rehearsal, we'd go to a restaurant and talk about all the kids that were in the play. And we'd have great laughter, a lot of laughter. And our plays were wonderful. They were, everybody was in it and everybody did something silly and wonderful. And that's what I remember. I remember the great times we had laughing over the plays. Lenka, wherever you are, keep laughing. Goodbye.
Right. That was wonderful. That was succinct. Great story. So I guess we'll proceed with the friends. I've Marla Truini.
Hi. Yes. Hi, everybody.
Hi, Marla.
Hi, Nico. Hi, everybody. I've been thinking so much about intergenerational friendships since losing Lenka a month ago. And although she was my mother's age, we were genuinely best friends. She's been the steadiest, most constant friend of my life. She was a mentor, a kindred spirit, the epitome of matriarchal wisdom and beauty. And I've been reflecting on what made our friendship tick. And as many of you have noticed, it did all come down to an essential element, which was her curiosity. Lenka was endlessly curious. And when her curiosity was about me, my life, my students, my projects, the who, what, where, when, and why of all my challenges. If I were to identify the greatest gift she ever gave me, and she gave me so many, I would say that she sought to understand me. And in doing so, I could be more fully myself. So meeting Lenka was a really pivotal moment in my life. I wouldn't be a theater teacher at all if I didn't have Lenka as my mentor. Theater brought us together, and she really taught me how to work with young people, how to encourage and support them. And she was with me every step of the way through dozens and dozens of school performances, coaching, guiding, asking questions, and she never missed a show. What a gift it was for me and for my students to know that she was right there in the front row, house right, cheering them on. Lenka was a Hall of Fame listener. Eileen, you also mentioned that. Tapping into Lenka's power to know when to speak and when to listen has been a great lesson for me in my work as a theater teacher and as, of course, as a human being. We had so much fun together, regularly driving into New York to see shows. I'd wait until we get in the car to start the drive home before asking, so what did you think? And most of the time, there were lots of good and interesting things to discuss, but occasionally Lenka would reply, I hated it a lot. And those were the best postmortems, because we would try to imagine what the director could possibly have been thinking and coming up with a million ways that we could have done it better. Lenka loved Roxbury, the town, the people, the beauty, and the comfort of her home. And it was a tremendous gift that she was able to live there until her last breath. She would often recount the lucky happenstance that brought the family to that South Street property, ever grateful to the fates for her good fortune. And we would always say, I can't imagine my life here in Roxbury without you. And nothing could have been further from the truth. I mean, further from the truth. Nothing could be more than the truth. So for the Peterson O'Connor family, I want you to know how much you've meant to us, to Joe and Chris and Kate and I, Dan, Lenka, Glynis, Doug, Lindsay, Hannah, Brian and Josh, Sean and Jolene, and JD, Darren and Eileen, and especially Kevin. We have just cherished our times together, as many of you have mentioned, the Christmas Eve caroling and the glug and Brian's hilarious parodies, holding each other up through laughter and tears with a deep commitment to honoring each other's humanity, cherishing each other, recognizing each other's beauty. And now it's our turn to pick up the baton and run the next lap, bringing like a special brand of unconditional love to future generations who need it now more than ever. Sorry. In my last conversation with Lenka, she told me how grateful she was for her beautiful life. Gratitude was her mantra. Gratitude for her beautiful family, all of you, her beautiful friends, her many students. My hope is that we will continue the work that was so critically important to Lenka to make the world a just and equitable place to be willing to be in dialogue with each other, which means developing that critical skill of knowing when to talk and when to listen, to suspend judgment and to stay curious. This is Lenka's legacy. Theater is the glue that holds us together. Thank you.
Thank you. That was beautiful. Love it.
Love you.
So I think we have a presentation from Wyatt shows now. I'm not sure who's presenting it, but Teresa and Barbara and Eileen. I'm sorry, I muddled on the order of
these. That's next okay. Events.
Okay.
Hi, Barbara. Hi.
And the lyrics are in the chat. If that's yeah. what.
We'll okay. get to that. Hi, everybody. This is Barbara. I am here to introduce Teresa Schleifer, who many of you know and remember as Terry Sattler, one of the earliest members of Wyatt, and with a voice like an angel. And she's going to sing a song for us that we sang in one of our first reviews of Wyatt, and that is Day Is Done by Peter Yarrow. Sung by Peter, Paul, and Mary. And this song, as we see it, is a tribute to Lenka from all of the children, all of the kids that she encouraged to take the stage, all of the children and in New Rochelle, in New York, in Harlem, in Connecticut, everywhere, hundreds of children whose lives she changed forever and who learned from her that the answer is love. And so if you know the song, you can just sing along. If you'd like to see the lyrics, all you have to do is click on the button that says chat. It's the middle of the line right below the Zoom screen. And you'll have to scroll down to see all of them. But if you don't want to click the chat button or scroll down and you just want to listen to Teresa as she sings this beautiful song with her beautiful voice, then just let it wash over you. So thank you to everyone in the family who, as Glynis said and Brian said, had to share their mom with so many of us. And our gratitude is with all of you tonight. So over to you, Teresa.
Thank you, Barbara. And thank you all for letting me be part of this celebration of Lenka. Tell me why you're crying, my son. I know you're frightened like everyone. Is it the thunder in the distance you fear? Will it help if I stay very near? I am here. And if you take my hand, my son, all will be well when the day is done. And if you take my hand, my son, all will be well when the day is done. 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 Do you ask why I'm sighing, my son? You shall inherit what mankind has done. Sorrow and woe. If you ask me why this is so, I really don't know. And if you take my hand, my son, all will be well when the day is done. And if you take my hand, my
A request, a last minute request from Barbara. There was Eileen, another Eileen was going to come on and read a selection. Let me, Eileen Bartarisian?
Bartarisian, yes.
Thank you, sorry. Just got it. Yes, I hear you're going to, you've got a reading selected for us.
I do. I was asked to share with everyone something that Hervé wrote to the O'Connor family. And unfortunately, he cannot be here with us today. So I will be reading this for him. Lenka's greatest lesson was go outside yourself and play. I liked living in Lenka's effervescent world that was laughter and poignancy, assurance and resilience. It is such good fortune, this happiness, to have had her in my life and actually rejoice that she was happy, I was in hers. People always felt she saw them fully with those hopeful eyes, and we were always rewarded seeing the best of ourselves through her, for she showed us how to be beautiful. Thank you.
No, thank you very much. So that's the end of the formal program that we have lined up so far. But if anybody who is still with in the chatter that wants to share a memory, chime in and add an anecdote of their own, that is welcome now. You could raise your hand, or you can unmute your mic, and there we are.
Green somehow.
How do I do that?
I see you. You're on camera, and we can hear you.
Can you see me?
We can see you, Gene.
Okay. Can I tell my short story?
Please do.
Thank you very much. I have to speak clearly because I know Lenka is listening, because she told me that I needed to speak clearly. And I met Lenka in an acting class where I didn't belong. They needed some spots. I think the other person might have been a novice carpenter, but I was in an acting class, and I met Lenka, and she started talking to me, And all of a sudden, I felt like somebody. And I was astounded how friendly she was and how helpful she was. And after that, I did some readings. And then I auditioned for a role and got a role in a play after all these years. And I just couldn't tell you how much Lenka came into my life and changed my life. It was so amazing. I was amazed that I could be something different, but Lenka opened that window for me. We would have lunch occasionally at the GWN, and we would talk about religion and politics, but that would only take about 30 seconds because we agreed on everything. So we would end up talking about food and the weather, which was fine because I was in Lenka's company. And I just want to end with this. When I was 10 years old, growing up in El Paso, there was a lottery, a raffle at a department store. And I won a little book. And my mother looked at me and she said, "You're going to be lucky, Jean. You're going to be lucky in life." And so Lenka was a woman from Omaha who changed my life. I cannot tell you how much she changed my life. And the other woman from Omaha, I met a lot earlier in life, and that was my mother, Rose. So I finally want to say one thing about Glennis, who I've met through Lenka. And I'm going to use some very high-powered vernacular, some very sophisticated English to end this, to describe Glennis. Glennis, wow, comma, OMG. You are such a sweetheart of a person. Thank you for all of your help. And thank all of you in this family. I, like my mother from Omaha said, have always been lucky. And Lenka just gave me an opportunity to really, really be lucky. Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome. Thank you so much. And just remember for everybody that we are going to have a website. There's going to be a website where you can continue this conversation and keep adding comments. And I, you know, if you saw this, this is being recorded. So you can watch this ceremony and all of her video clips again. So anyone else who wants to chime in, we are getting to the official end of our scheduled Zoom. So I understand if it's time for people to go about their evening, have dinner.
Nico, can you hear me?
I can.
Is me talking?
I can hear you, June.
Okay, I just like to say that I keep a postcard from Lenka on my desk, and it ends with a little piece of advice, which is life blossoms when you let go of expectations. And I just thought that was something I'd want to share with everybody, from Lenka's beautiful handwriting to everyone here. What a wonderful tribute. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. This was just so moving. I'm so happy to have been able to be with you all.
And thank you. Thanks. For being here.
Can with I us. Say something?
Please do.
I'm Barbara Henry. I'm actually the first selectman here in Roxbury. And this was so wonderful to see her and hear her voice today. It was really a wonderful tribute. And thank you, Glennis, for getting the information out so that some of us could, you know, just be here. So aside from this amazing family that we've heard today, Roxburyans were also her family. and we loved her. Her love overflowed to many of us who were so lucky to live here and to know her. Eileen said it first, I think, then it was repeated over and over again, that Lenka, for me, she walked the talk. If you were in her presence, you were her whole world at that moment. And she gave you her full attention. There was no getting around that. You just felt it. I don't care who you were. Her smile absolutely brightened the room. And I don't know of anyone that can compare to her in living life with passion. She could meet you wherever you were. If you were the trash man or the president, she was real. She was real. She was truth. Her energy encompassed you, and you could not leave her without a smile on your own face. From everyone here in Roxbury, we are so grateful that our paths crossed. Lenka, God bless you. Please tell Jean Merkland hello. She told me that it was her friend who she went skinny dipping in the back, in the water behind the house. And we miss her too, just from Roxbury with love. Thank you. Thank you for having us today.
She loved Roxbury. We all know that.
Well, we're all richer for having known her, every yeah. single one of us.
Definitely.
I just wanted to say something.
Oh, hi.
Just something real quick. Lori Newkirk. We have a local community theater, and we had a fundraiser, and Rosemary Foley, her dear friend's play was accepted, and she contacted us and said, I have two actors who can play the part. And we thought, oh dear. And then it turned out to be Lenka Peterson and Glenys O'Connor. If you can imagine how nervous is the director to suddenly have these two stars come to the, to come be in the play. And they just couldn't have been kinder and nicer in this community theater setting. And it was a true honor. And it was a comedy about a mother and a daughter. So you can only imagine how incredible it was. So I just wanted to say she was amazing, so kind, and made us all feel so safe. So just thank you for including me.
Nico, I think I'm coming in right at the scuttle last. And so if you just give me a second.
Please join the party.
I'm really bad at this, but a thank you to Lenka through Glenys, because Glenys, thank you for sending me a picture of all the art that I had given Lenka over the years. I don't know who does that, but you know, I loved your mom, and I'm gonna miss her. So, love to Lenka, but love to everybody who was touched by Lenka. That's it. Now you know why I waited till the last.
Yeah, it's beautiful. I mean, how am I gonna follow that, huh? So I guess we could go ahead and wrap up the event. Darren, Glenys, Brian, Sean, anyone want to say anything here? Or?
Just our most heartfelt thanks to everyone who joined, you know, this most important celebration of our mother's life. So thank you so much for being here, and thank you for sharing all of these terrific memories and comments. Have a wonderful rest of the weekend for what's left of it. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you all. Thank you.
Wonderful to see all of your faces.
Nico, I'd like to add one thing. I want to thank everybody who put all those beautiful comments in the chat. I didn't get to thank all of you individually, but thank you. And also, just in case you know, in the bottom of the chat, there are three dots that say more, and you can click them, and you can click save chat, which I've done. And Nico,
you too.
And then all the chats will be saved because I cherish everything that you all said. And
saved them too.
Thank you.
Thank you. I was honored. It's just great to be a part of this.
Ditto here. Ditto here, you guys. Ditto over here. I am hugging you all right now, every single one of you. And this has been just incredible. Thank you. I love you.
Thank you. Thank you all so very much. It's just means the world to us again. And over the last weeks, your messages have just been wonderful. And thank you again. Much love.
Well, thank you, everybody, on that. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Thanks, Nico.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great job, Nico.
Thank you so much.
Thank you all.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Nico.
You're welcome. So glad to be a part of this. Everybody have a wonderful evening.
You too.
And the meeting for all.
Bye.
Love you, everyone.
Thank you, you guys. Love you.
Love you. Thank you.